So let's now see how we set up the recruitment module for this customer. Okay. So the best way to set up recruitment module or any other HCM module for that matter is to follow a different approach, an approach that works no matter which HCM ERP software we are doing this implementation. So now let's see what all do we have in this approach, you know, what it tells you to do. So it tells you to first understand the organization, then identify the elements to set up, okay, and then we gather the requirement around those individual elements, okay, so that makes job a lot easier. And once we have the requirements, we set up all those elements individually. And once all of them are built or set up, we integrate them. So we integrate those elements so that the end-to-end process works. And then at the end, we actually test what we have built. Okay. So starting with understanding the organization. So in this particular step, we have to basically study the organization that we are doing this implementation for. And when we say that we need to study the organization, we basically have to know the industry that it belongs to, its structure, organizational structure, the locations where all it operates, and then the type of staff which works there. Okay. So starting with industry. So as we know, we are doing this implementation for a restaurant. The name is ST Restaurant. So we know that it belongs to hospitality industry. So now let's see what our location it operates. So it is mainly based out of Queensland, Australia. It's a state in Australia. Okay. So now we know the region, right? It is in Australia. So now since it's a state and this restaurant has many branches, so we'll now see what all places in Queensland this restaurant operates. Okay. So these are those locations. So right here you see this is the main location and these are other locations where it operates. Okay, so this is the main branch of this restaurant and these are other branches. Okay, now we'll see what kind of organization structure and what kind of staff does this restaurant have across all these locations. Okay, so definitely since it's a restaurant, so there would be cook across all these branches. There would be chef, right? Every restaurant has a chef. There would be bartender. If it has bar, then there would be a bartender. There would be more than one bartenders basically. There would be restaurant manager, right, who manages the day-to-day operations of the restaurant. Then we have a wait staff, right? And then we have a reservationist who actually manages the reservations. And then there would be someone who manages the finance. We call them as cost center managers, right? So in each of these branches, there would be someone who looks after the finance, right? But above all these, there would be a management also, right? Since after all, this is also a company and every company has its management, right? People who are up in the hierarchy. So in this also there would be, you know, people who are in the higher management, right? So let's say they are there. So there would be a CEO, chief executive officer. There would be a CMO, chief marketing officer, CEO, chief operating officer, and there would be HR manager, right? So all of them, they presumably sit in the main branch of this restaurant. Okay, so they sit in this main branch, right? And all other branches, they have the usual staff to manage their day-to-day operations. Okay, all right. So now we just saw the organization itself. We understood, you know, its structure, what all location it operates, which industry it belongs, and things like that, right? So we understood the organization, which means the first step is done. Now let's identify the elements to set up. Now in order to do this, we have to basically recall the recruitment life cycle and we have to break down that life cycle into elements, and those will be the elements to set up. So let us first see what is the recruitment life cycle that we are talking about? All right, so this is that recruitment life cycle. So it starts with creating requisition, then posting the job on career portal, and then candidates apply for the job. Then the screening happens, okay? Then the interview, followed by the extending the offer. Candidates accepts or declines the offer, and then the candidate is hired, all right? And then we have onboarding, which is part of the core HR module, and we will not get into that today, okay? So now let's break down this life cycle. As you see in this life cycle, there are these blocks that make up the recruitment process, right? So let's break it down and see what all elements do we have. So this is how it looks like after we break it down. So we have these individual blocks or elements that make up the recruitment life cycle. You have general configuration, okay? So every recruitment process has some general configuration things, some general process, right? Which is different from the individual processes, such as offer letter or requisition or applicant profile, etc. There are some general processes. We'll get into that. Then we have requisition functionality. So there are a couple of more things associated with the requisition functionality, such as when someone raises a requisition, there is approval workflow, and there are email notifications, etc. Similarly, have offer letter functionality. So someone from the organization sends the offer letter to the selected candidates. There is also an approval associated with that, and we also have email notifications. Then there is applicant profile, right? So when candidates, they apply for the job, they have to provide certain information when they are actually registering themselves in the career site and then applying for the job. So we have applicant profile. Then we have hiring stages. Now if you recall, the recruitment process has certain hiring stages. So the first one is as soon as the jobs are published, candidates apply for the job. So we have first hiring stage as application received, and then the screening happens, right? So the screening process is the second hiring stage. So this is to track the overall life cycle, okay? We'll see that in detail. Then we have hire workflow. Now, hire workflow is something which kicks off after the candidate has accepted the offer. So somebody from the organization, they initiate the hire workflow actually in the system, and it goes through an approval workflow, and there are email notifications as well, right? Then we have questionnaires. I mean, these are not in sequence, okay? These are individual elements we are going through. So in questionnaire, you have when applicants apply for the job, they have to answer certain number of questions related to that job, which are required for the job. And based on the answers of those questions, they are allowed to further proceed in the job application process, right? So, and then there are interview questionnaires, which interviewers use when they conduct interview of the candidates, right? There are certain number of questions that they have to ask as per the organization policy. So yeah, so and then we have obviously email notifications. This is also one of the elements. So in many of these other elements, there are always workflows and email notifications, right? So we have then workflow. So these two elements are part of these other elements like requisition, offer letter functionality, hire workflow. So this is all about these individual elements. Now let's arrange them and see how, you know, they look like. So now we will actually perform this setup in this order, okay? That's why we have arranged all these elements in this manner, okay? So the reason we have put in the workflow and notifications below some of these elements is that because these two sub elements, you can say, are part of these main elements. So like in requisition process we have workflow, approval workflow, and the notifications, right? Likewise in offer letter process, when the offer letter is extended, we have workflow and the notifications. Similarly, in the higher workflow also, we have approval workflow and the notification. So we have arranged all these elements in such a manner that we will follow this when we perform the setup. Okay, so now we have understood the elements to setup. Let's see what next we have. So the next is actually gathering the requirement around the elements that we have identified. So we have individual elements that we have to set up. Now before we could set up those elements, we have to gather the requirement around those elements. So as you know, these are the elements that we have identified. Now we will actually go back to the customer and we will gather the requirement for each of these elements. We have broken down the whole life cycle, the recruitment life cycle, into these elements. So now these are small modules, you can say. Okay, now it becomes easy for us to gather the requirement, collate all the requirements, feedbacks from the customer, prepare the functional design documents, etc. So now it can be divided among various consultants. There can be more than one person working on these, and one person can pick up each of these elements and they can do the setup simultaneously, so that way we can expedite this whole implementation thing. Okay, so this is the advantage of breaking down the whole setup into small pieces, which we are calling these elements, and then proceed with the setup. So let us now gather the requirement for each of these elements one by one. So starting with general configuration. Okay, so now general configuration, as the name suggests, there are some high level organizational policies around recruitment. So what kind of questions we are going to ask to when we go back to customer as far as the general configurations are concerned? So the questions would most likely be like, what are the hiring managers and the recruiters in your organization? So we go back to customer. Obviously we don't know who are the hiring managers in the organization. We as a consultant don't know that, right? So we have to go back to the customer and ask them, who are the hiring managers and recruiters in your organizations? Okay, are they based on the positions or they are specific individuals who perform this job, right? Then what are the vendors for job posting? Okay, so once the requisitions are created, now we have to post the jobs across various job portals. So when we call vendors, these are actually job portals. So Indeed, LinkedIn, then for Australia we have Seek, we have Monster. So all these are career sites or the job portals, and we are calling them vendors. So what all vendors this organization has association with, we have to ask them, because there might be integration required between these vendors and the organization for which we are actually setting up the recruitment module, right? So we have to ask. Then whether the approval workflow is allowed to be bypassed by someone. So this question is actually about the cases when, let's say, somebody who is very up in the hierarchy in the organization. So if you talk about this particular organization, which is a restaurant, so somebody like COO, right? If they prefer to hire somebody, is it allowed for them to bypass the approval workflow, or is there any other person who is allowed to bypass some part of the workflows? So we can ask this sort of questions as far as the general configuration is concerned. Okay, then obviously some specific things like their cover image for the recruitment site, the logo, the career site, etc. So when I say career site, it's not those recruitment sites like Indeed, Monster, etc. Career site in within the organization. So in every organization you have a career page, right? So there are two ways you can apply for a job in an organization. You go to the organization's website, you go to the career section, and you will see the openings, current openings, and you apply from there. Or you can go to a third party job portal or vendor, we are calling them, like Indeed, Seek, Monster, etc. And you go there and then you see the job listing there for this organization, you apply the job from there. But the one which we are talking about in this particular question is the career site, which is within the organization. Okay, for the organization. So whether they are using a dedicated career site or not. So we have to ask all these questions as part of the general configuration element. So this is a general configuration area, and we should ask all these questions. Now it's not specific to a particular industry. Since we are talking about restaurants, so it's not that you have to ask these questions only for the build that you are doing for a restaurant or a hotel which is in hospitality industry. It is applicable for every type of industry, whether you are doing this implementation for a bank or IT company or a manufacturing company. You can all ask all these questions for all those. Okay, so now since you are asking these questions to your customer or the organization, let's say you get these answers. Okay, now it's not assumption, it's actually fact. So we went back to them and we asked all these questions and we got these responses. So the restaurant that we are building currently, which is a ST restaurant, so they gave us these answers. So chef, restaurant manager and the cost center manager are the hiring managers and the recruit. Only these can initiate the recruitment process. Okay, who are the vendors for the job posting? So currently, let's say they have LinkedIn and the Indeed as third-party vendors for job posting. Is bypassing approval allowed for someone in the organization? No, it's not allowed. So no matter who initiates the recruitment process, they have to go through the whole approval life cycle. Okay, the approval workflow, they cannot bypass it. The process needs to be followed by everyone. Okay, and then is there any logo, cover image or career site? Yes, we do have. They have given the logo for now. Okay, we'll talk about the career site bit later. Okay, and the cover image they haven't given. So cover image and logo you can always download from their website. You can just go to their website and click on the top. Most likely the logo and the cover image would be on the top. You can use those and you can simply apply it in the during the setup. Okay, so this is what we can do. Now, so we are done with the questions and the requirement gathering for the general configuration element. Okay, so the second element is requisition. Now let's go back to customer and ask what the requisition functionality is. Okay, so now with the requisition, there is a requisition form. Okay, so every organization, when they create a requisition, obviously they are going to have a requisition form. Okay, and now requisition form is actually something where all the attributes of that requisitions are defined. So requisition is basically a demand to fill up a position, a vacant position. Okay, so let's say we have a vacant position for chef. So somebody from the organization, they will create a requisition to fill in that position. Now apart from requisition form, we will have a workflow, a approval workflow, because if the requisition is submitted, what all approvers are there to approve that requisition before it is final, before it is considered to be final. Okay, and during that workflow process or the approval workflow process, there will be notifications. Okay, which will be triggered to various stakeholders which are involved in that approval workflow process. So we have to go back to customer and ask three things surrounding the requisition element. One, what is their requisition form look like? What are the approvers involved in the requisition workflow? And what all notifications do we have? Okay, so let's get into all that. So the first thing is the requisition form. Okay, now this particular customer, they haven't given any details about their requisition form. Okay, we have to use the default requisition form that our HCM ERP softwares provides. Okay, so now some of the ERP softwares, to reduce the effort and etc., they create a sample form, so where they put in all the attributes that can possibly be there in case of a requisition form. Okay, because a requisition is a requisition, right? You know, barring few fields, most of the attributes would be same, whether you are working in a restaurant or you are working in a IT company or in a bank. So except for few fields where there can be some specific details required from organization to organization, but most of the fields are gonna be same. So since there is a lot of commonality, so
some advanced HCM ERP softwares, they have a default model requisition form. Now you can we can show this requisition form to the customer and ask them, so we have this default version, this is a model form, you can look into that, you can see all the fields that it has, where we can capture the attributes of the requisition that is raised in your organization, and then you can suggest if any further additional attributes are required to be captured while creating a requisition. Okay, so this is what we can suggest. So in our particular case, this is what we are going to do, because they haven't given any requisition form to us. So we are done with the requisition form, it's sorted, requirement is gathered. Now the next thing is the requisition workflow, approval workflow we are talking about. Okay, so now we have to ask, this is very important, the workflow is very, very important to set up a particular process, right? So in the workflow, you have these three types of stakeholders. One, restaurant manager and the chef. Second, the cost center manager. And the third, the HR manager. If you remember, when we were looking into the organization, when we were actually understanding the organizations, we saw all these different type of staffs, right? Restaurant manager or chef, the cost center manager, and the HR manager, right? Now, so when we go back to the customer, what they're saying is, in our company, in our restaurant, restaurant manager and the chef are designated to create a requisition. So if there is a vacancy, and if let's say there is a need of a cook, then restaurant manager and the chef would go ahead and create a requisition. Okay, so after they create the requisition, it will then go to the cost center manager. You remember, for each of those locations, there were cost center managers, right? So depending upon, so if the requisition is created, it would go, a email notification would be triggered to the respective cost center manager. So if the requisition was raised for, let's say, Brisbane location, so the notification would go to the cost center manager of that Brisbane location. It would not go to the other cost center managers. Okay, so this is how they want it to be built. And obviously that cost center manager then has to approve or deny that requisition. Okay, so once they approve, once the cost center manager of that particular location approves the requisition, then there would be a second notification triggered to the HR manager. Now if you remember, there was only one HR manager or the HR team in the whole organization, so that sits in the main branch of the restaurant, which is in Brisbane. Okay, so after the cost center manager approves the requisition, a notification would go to the HR manager of the organization, and HR manager then have to approve or deny that requisition request. And once the approval is done, HR manager then would post the job on the career portal. Okay, so this phase is basically about when the job openings are posted to LinkedIn, to Indeed, Monster, Seek, all these websites, and also in the company's career website. Okay, so on all these different portals, right? Now, so this is how the requisition workflow works for this restaurant. This is how it looks like. Okay, so this is also done. Now, as part of this workflow, there were obviously the approvals and there were notifications, right? Now, since there is a notification or email, we obviously are going to have a subject line, a body, a sender email ID, etc., right? So we have to ask the customer, provide us the email body that you want us to configure, so that when the requisition is submitted, the email notification has a certain language or the body that you are expecting, that you are currently using. Okay, so let's get into that now. Requisition emails. So as part of the requisition workflow, there would be email notifications triggered, right? So now those will be like when the request is submitted. So when the requisition request is submitted, so it first goes to cost center manager. So that email, what will be the body and the language and the subject line would be of that email. Second one would be when the requisition is approved. So for the approval case, what would be the body and the subject line, etc. So we have to ask all that. Let's say the request is rejected or declined, then there would be a certain content of that email, right? And likewise, when the request is modified. So if the request is rejected, then obviously it's going to be back to go back to the request creator, who has created the request. So they will be asked to modify it and then resubmit again, right? So now, so in that case, what would be the email content, right? So this is how it works. So as far as the emails are concerned for the requisition, so let's say we gathered all these email details of these email notifications. Now I'm not going to open each and every email notifications and show it to you guys that this is how they are provided. Let's assume they have given this detail that this should be the body, this should be the subject line, and this should be the sender ID. Okay, we are not going to see. Now the requisition is done. Okay, so the next one is applicant profile. Okay, now as you know, applicant profile is, it comes in picture when the candidates, they see the job openings in the career sites and they go ahead and apply for the job, right? So when they apply for the job, they have to provide a lot of information about them, right? Their career history, their personal information, their education, their certifications, if they have done any. So all those details that they have to provide. So you have to go back to the customer and ask what their applicant profile should look like. So what information they expect a candidate to provide when they are applying for the job. So you have to go back to the customer and ask this information. Okay, we actually went to the customer and asked them, and then they given us an applicant form that they currently use. It's a Word document, okay, that they currently used. They give it to the candidates and they fill it in, and then they provide this information. So this is where we are basically storing all the documents pertaining to this implementation. Okay, so here we have the application form that we received from the customer. This is how it looks like. So in this section, all these are personal details and the communication details, right? Where they ask the name, address, contact details of the candidate. And then we have educational history section, where the candidate has to provide all the their education history. Then we have the employment history, where candidate has to give if they have any prior work experience, right? And then we have this some specific questions that they ask to the applicants, right? If they would continue another employment while they get selected. And then obviously the references, right? The professional references. And then we have some, this declaration that they shouldn't have any criminal record. And then at the end there is a declaration section where the candidate has to sign. So this is their current form that they use, that they give the candidates, that they give it to the candidates, and then the candidate has to fill all this form. So obviously at the end they have a signature and a date field. Anyway, so customer has given this form, so we know how their applicant profile should look like. Okay, so we have to build the application applicant profile in such a way that it captures all these details, right? We'll get into that. So the applicant profile is done. We just went through that. We obtained the details from the customer. Okay. Now, after the applicant profile, we have offer letter functionality. In the offer letter functionality, what we need to ask is that how their offer letter look like. This is the first thing that we need to ask. There would be a PDF document that they use to, fill in some details and then send it to the selected candidates. So we need to ask them. We have to obtain that PDF document or the Word document. If there is any approval workflow is there in the offer letter functionality, such as, let's say, if restaurant manager prepares the offer letter, then whether they have to send it to somebody for approval or not. And if that approval is there, then we need to ask the customer whether you have any such approval process or not, or it is directly sent by the restaurant manager to the selected candidates. And all obviously if there is a workflow, then there has to be notifications, right? That we need to ask whether you have any email notifications that need to be sent to the applicant or the person who this offer letter is being sent for approval. So obviously there will be email notifications, right? Because when the offer letter is sent to the candidate, so candidate would get a cover letter sort of thing that congratulations, you have been selected in the organization, and this is your salary details, etc. So we need to basically ask the customer all these details. So the first thing that, as I said, is the offer letter, right? So offer letter is we went to the customer and ask them, right? So they gave us the offer letter that they used. So let's see that. Offer letter is in this folder. So this is the employment contract that they call it. Okay. So this is the format of that they have given to us. Up here is the logo and then full-time employment contract, the name of the restaurant, and here would be the candidate name who has been selected. So these are all the contract details. So I'm not going to go through all these details, but these are the contract details in the offer letter, right? And at the end you have someone like HR in the organization. They have to sign it and they have to send it to the candidate, and the candidate has to sign it here. So signed by employer and signed by candidate, both. Okay. And at the end there are some details, right? So in Australia, since we are talking about Australia, so in Australia they have this particular format of employment contract. Every company would have this format. So they would at least have this detail at the very end in the offer letter, where there would be company name, the name of the candidate, and then the position offered, and the when the expected start date is, and then their pay, right? So how much they are going to be paid as part of this contract. So this is a Australia specific format, just remember that. So this is the offer letter that we have to build for this customer in our HCM ERP system. So we just saw the offer letter, right? Now, as I told you, there would be a workflow in the offer letter process, right? Now this is the whole hire work. For now you don't have to understand the whole thing, okay? So the one related to offer letter is right here. So this is the one which tells the offer letter functionality, okay? So but this is the entire hire life cycle, but this part is actually where the offer letter flow is, okay? So as you can see, after the interview is done and the references visa check is done, HR manager initiates the offer letter, extends the offer letter to the applicant, selected applicant. So a notification is sent to the applicant, as you can see here. Then applicant has to either accept or decline the offer. If they decline the offer, then the process would end, okay? But if the applicant accepts the offer, you see, then the cost center manager has to initiate the hire process. And that's when the candidate will be brought into the system. So up until this point, candidate is not yet in the system, in the HR system. They are in the recruitment system, okay? From this point onwards, they will be brought into the HR module, okay? So this part of it is the offer letter workflow. So you see there is a notification, right? So after candidate accepts the offer, then there would be another notification sent to the person who has extended the offer letter, which is the HR manager. And even if the candidate declines the offer, even then a notification will be sent to the HR manager, which is not shown here, but the notification is there. This is an ideal process which is followed in all the organizations, okay? As I said, in every workflow there are email notifications. So in case of offer letter also there are email notification. I just told you that. So once the offer letter is extended by HR manager, email notification is sent to the applicant. So we need to ask the customer what should be the content of that email, the subject line, etc. Obviously we need to go back to them and ask this information. Offer letter accepted. When candidate accepts the offer letter, who all should be notified and what should be the email content? When candidate declines the offer letter, then who all should be notified and what should be the content? So the customer or the organization told us that this is what their requirement is. When the offer letter is sent, the email notifications will be sent to the applicant, which we saw in the previous slide. When the offer letter is accepted by the candidate, email notification should be sent to the HR manager, and as well as when it is denied or declined by the candidate. So when the candidate declines the offer letter, the email notification should be sent to HR manager who had initiated the offer letter, okay? So we got the content of these emails. I'm not going to go through all of them. Let's just assume that we have obtained these details from the customer, okay? Essentially, we are done with the offer letter functionality. Now, next is the hiring stage. Okay. So the hiring stage basically is about tracking the whole recruitment life cycle. So using hiring stage, you can know at any given point of time where we are with the recruitment life cycle. Okay. So when the job postings are done on the career sites, then applicants, they apply for the job. So the hiring stage. So we will click or we will tick this hiring stage, application received. Okay. And since we are clicking this hiring stage, that the application has been received, so there would be email notification. So now we have to go back to customer and ask them, we have what all hiring stages they have, okay, and whether they have any email notifications, they want us to plug in any email notifications against some of these hiring stages. So well, see, hiring stage is something which varies from customer to customer, okay? Some HCM ERPs, they might have a different name of it, hiring process or hiring steps, something like that. But the HCM ERP software that we are implementing the recruitment module on, it calls this a hiring stage. Other HCM softwares, they would have different name of it. So we have to basically go back to customer and ask if they want us to build these hiring stages in the system so that they can track where the recruitment life cycle is, at what stage it is, okay? And then we ask them whether you want to plug in any notifications in some of the hiring stages. So they told us yes. So as soon as the application is received on any particular job opening, So the hiring manager, the person who has initiated the hire process, they should get a notification that there was a candidate who has applied for the job in this job opening, against this job opening. So this is a notification that should be sent to the hiring manager. Okay, they want us to do this. Then after that, there would be a phone screen, a screening, a telephonic screening kind of thing that would happen, right? So they don't want any notification with that. When the interview is scheduled, so they want us to send a notification to the applicant that you have an interview scheduled on this and this date with this person, okay? So when the interview is scheduled, they want us to send a notification, all right? And that notification should be sent to the candidate. And when the interview happens, the hiring manager, who's actually cost center manager in this case, they should inform the HR manager that this candidate has been selected. So please go ahead and initiate the offer to this candidate or extend the offer to this candidate. After that, we have all these offer decline. If the candidate declines the offer, then we'll take this hiring stage and then it will tell us that the offer has been declined by the candidate. And if the candidate accepts the offer, then we'll take this hiring stage and like so on and so forth. Okay, so this is the purpose of the hiring stages. Now our HCM software actually addresses some of the requirement using hiring stages. Some other HCM software can address these requirements using a different methodology, okay? It can vary from one software to other software. So our HCM software, which we are going to implement this recruitment module on, uses the hiring stages to actually send notification to the hiring managers or the recruiters when the application is received, when the interview is scheduled, when the notification should be sent to the HR to extend the offer. So, but some other HCM softwares, they might use a different methodology, okay? So let's not get confused what we are doing here. So let's say we obtain the requirement for the hiring stages. This is what they need, all right? So the next is questionnaire. So questionnaire is a library where we store a number of questions that are used at different stages of recruitment process. So there are three types of questionnaire, okay, that we define in recruitment module. The first one is applicant questionnaire. So this comes in picture when applicants apply for the jobs. So organization, they ask certain questions to those new applicants, such as, do you have a right to work in Australia or whichever country they're applying for, right? Do you have a valid visa? So these kind of questions. Second one, interview questionnaire. So this is a list of questions that the interviewer is supposed to ask to the interviewee during the course of an interview as per the organization policy. So organization has a set of questions that they want the interviewer to ask to the interviewee, and they have to capture the interviewee's response. The third one is a reference questionnaire. So this comes in picture when the candidate is selected and they give some references so that the organization for which they are interviewing can verify their profile. So the organization which is conducting the interview or who is hiring the candidate would call these references. A reference can be the candidate's co-worker or their manager or somebody else, but they must be from within the organization. So they would call those references and they would verify certain details. So for that, the person who is actually calling the references, they have to ask a set of questions as per the organization policy. So we can store those questions in the reference as a reference questionnaire. Now we have to go back to the customer and ask if they use any of these questionnaires or not. So let's go back to them. So we checked with the customer, and so they are basically using the applicant questionnaire and the interview questionnaire. At the moment, they are not using any reference questionnaire. Okay, so let's see how do they look like. So we have stored those questionnaires in one of these folders. So we go to questionnaire. So this is the interview questionnaire, and this is how it looks like. So here on the top you see the details of the candidate and the interviewer. Okay, there are some instructions for the interviewer. These are the instructions for the interviewer. So this questionnaire will be with the interviewer, the person who is taking the interview, as to what all questions they're supposed to ask. So you see these are the list of questions, right? So, and they have to then capture the candidate's response also while they are asking these questions. So there are some 5 questions that the interviewer has to ask the interviewee. So we have to set up these questions onto our ERP system. Okay, the second one is applicant questionnaire, which they gave us, and apparently there is just one question that they want us to configure as part of the applicant questionnaire. So do you have a right to work in Australia? Okay, so this is a question that we need to set up so that whenever new candidates apply for the job, they answer this question. And this is a knockout question actually. So this will have 2 options, yes or no. If candidates click on no, then they will be thrown out of the application process because they cannot proceed with the application because they don't have a right to work in Australia. So this is the applicant questionnaire. So these are the 2 questionnaires, applicant and the interview questionnaire, that we need to set up. So after the questionnaire, let's finally see the hire workflow.
So hire workflow comes in picture when candidate has accepted the offer. Okay, so the person who has initiated this whole recruitment life cycle, in this particular case that would be chef and the restaurant manager, they would initiate the hire action. They would initiate the request to hire this candidate who has accepted the offer letter. Okay, so there are 3 components to it. The first one is new hire request form. So the new hire request form is basically the person who is initiating the hire request, they have to fill in this new hire request form. It's an electronic form. Okay, every HCM software, they have to provide this form, right? So this form is basically to fill in all the details of the new hire, the person who has accepted the offer and is now supposed to be hired into the system in the HR, so that their data can now be created into the HR system, right? So now this new hire request form contains personal information of the selected candidate, job information, right? So job information would contain things like job title, their manager details, line manager details, grade, working hours, things like that. So all the job specific details would be there in the job information section. Their payroll information will be there. So payroll information basically contains attributes like the payroll frequency, right? The pay group and things like that. Okay, then we have the compensation information. So the compensation information is basically the compensation data. So when the candidates was extended the offer letter, in the offer letter there was compensation detail mentioned, to which the candidate then agreed to, right? So the compensation detail can be an hourly rate, or it can be a CTC, a cost to company, annual compensation. Now, so every HCM ERP software, right, they should be intelligent enough to import the data into the new hire request form from requisition and the applicant profile. From requisition details page, these two set of informations can be imported into the new hire request form. So the system should be intelligent enough to do that, okay? Because when the requisition was created, these information were already provided pertaining to that requisition. And since the candidate is being hired based on this requisition, so the job information and the payroll information pertaining to that candidate must be imported from requisition details form into the new hire request form. So system should already do that. The HCM ERP software should already do that. As far as the personal information and the job information and the payroll information should be imported from the requisition details page, and the personal information and the compensation information should be imported from the applicant profile. So the point here is that any HCM software should be able to copy these details from the respective pages onto the new hire request form and populate the fields. Okay, so now we understood how the new hire request form is populated. So this is the first step in the new hire request workflow. So we need to go back to customer and ask them what is their new hire approval workflow. Who are all the stakeholders or the approvers involved in the new hire request? Okay, so we went to the customer and asked them, and this is what they gave.
Their hire workflow actually is this one. Okay, so you see, after candidate accepts the offer, the restaurant manager or the chef who has initiated the recruitment process would actually initiate the hire action, request to hire this candidate. So this person would actually put a request to hire the candidate that has accepted the offer, which would trigger a workflow. Okay, so obviously this person would fill up all the informations or all the organizational details pertaining to that new hire, the details that I've just told you, right? Then it would go to HR manager for approval. HR manager would get a notification as well as an approval request. So HR manager would then approve it, and then it will go to the cost center manager, who would receive a notification and as well as approval request. So the cost center manager would approve. Once they approve, the candidate will be actually hired into the system, into the HR module. So candidate would sit on the recruitment module until this request is initiated. Okay, so they would be part of the HR module. Their data would be in the HR module once they are hired. Okay, so this is the hire workflow. They have told who are the approvers in the hire action. The initiator is the restaurant manager or the chef who has initiated this whole recruitment life cycle, right from the requisition. And the approvers are HR manager and the cost center manager. Okay, and there are notifications involved in that. Okay, so now we know the workflow. Now let's get into the notification part. So obviously there is a request, there is a notification when the hire request is submitted, and it goes to the HR manager, right? So there would be a content to it. There would be a request approval notification. Once it is approved by the approvals, there would be a request rejected notification, and there would be a request. So in case the hire request is rejected by the approvals, then it should go back to the requester, right? And there should be a notification to the requester saying that this notification is meant for the requester. It says that your request has been rejected by so and so approver, so you have to modify it. So once the requester modifies the hire request, the reason for rejection can be anything. For example, let's say the person who is hiring the candidate or who has initiated the hire action may fill up some incorrect details, such as their line manager. They have put in an incorrect line manager on the request form, right? So that could be a reason for the rejection, right? So it is then sent back to the requester, and they have to modify it, correct the form, and then submit it again. So it will be again, it will again go through that whole approval life cycle. So the content of these emails they have provided to us, I'm not going to go through all those contents one by one. So let's just assume that they have given us the content as to what should be the subject, what should be the body of